across this room. Tell him what you're thankful for. Tell him how you love him. Jesus, we love you. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your peace. Jesus, thank you for your love. Jesus, thank you for choosing the cross. Thank you for choosing us. Father, we love you. Thank you for your presence, for your joy in this place. You are so, so good. Thank you, Lord. Amen and amen. Can we just lift up a shout of praise to the Lord in this place?
Empowered is receiving power and authority. At Oral Roberts University, we're raising up a generation of spirit-empowered leaders. Forbes has called ORU one of America's top colleges. Princeton Review called it the best in the West. The Daily Beast calls ORU one of the top five healthy universities. And the Travel Channel called the ORU campus stunning. We're training whole leaders for the whole world. It's our destiny. It may be yours, too.
Well, this morning I'm excited to introduce, I think, one of the most amazing next-gen leaders that I've ever met in my life. He serves as our director of spiritual life. Would you please welcome to the stage today, Mr. Augustine Mendoza.
Thanks, guys. Thanks. Y'all are awesome. Guys, I don't know about you, but I'm excited about this three-day weekend. I don't know, I need some rest. Anyone else need some rest? Just some sleep, some Netflix. I'm gonna be going to Disney Plus though. I don't know about y'all, but Disney Plus, they're on another level. My voice is feeling it a little bit. I caught a little something, so if you can say a prayer for your brother up here, my inflection may be limited. But I'm excited to share with you guys today a little bit. I always say tonight in chapel. Anyone else think it's like tonight in chapel, like all the time? It's the clouds. They got me. This morning, I'm just going to share a little bit. We're going to have some family time. Anybody like some family time at ORU? We're going to share, and I really thought it was interesting because what Pastor Matthew Barnett spoke on Wednesday, which was incredible, was really the foundation that I needed that was really going to be my entire introduction into my message today. So it's just amazing what God does and how he is planning and orchestrating things. And to give you guys some context, my undergrad career here, I spent 4 years. I studied ministry and leadership. Any other ministry and leadership majors out there? Some of the best years of my life. I loved my time. I learned so much. I developed a lot as a leader and as a man who's just learning how to love Jesus with his whole being. And that's really what this message this morning is really about. And I got a lot of great things out of my experience at ORU, but there was one thing that I got out of my experience that is better than anything else. And I would not be doing honor to her if I did not recognize her. Would you guys honor my wife and coworker, Allie Mendoza? I love you. Love you forever. Come on, somebody. There's still time until spring. Somebody say amen. Hey, my message this morning, if you're gonna take notes, and I would highly encourage it, my message title this morning is Consecrated. Consecrated. The definition of consecrated is to be dedicated to a sacred purpose. Everybody say dedicated. Dedicated to a sacred purpose. It was December of this past year. I was coming back from a missions trip to Haiti with my wife, and we were flying back into the States, and I just felt probably more strongly than I've ever felt before, the Lord dropped this message in my heart. And he said, the next time you preach it over you, you're going to preach this message. And he told me this in December. This is the most advance I've ever gotten for a message ever, and probably will ever get that much advance ever again. And it was in that moment that I knew like the Lord really wanted to do something. And so I would just ask for a moment, if you would just close your eyes, I just want you to posture your heart to receive from the Lord. So just wherever you are, close your eyes. I just want you to connect with the Lord. I know there's a lot of things going on. You're excited about the weekend. It's the end of this week. You're thinking about assignments and homework. But right now, I just want you to take a minute and fix your eyes on the cross. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Fix your eyes on the one that loved you so much that laid down his life. He gives you all of his attention. He gives you all of his affection, all of his love, all of his desire. And so, Lord, in this place, we give the same back to you. God, we love to sing thank you. Would our lives sing thank you. Here in this place, God, I know there's things you want to deposit. So deposit them, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, you can open your eyes. Don't go to sleep on me. It's good. It's a rainy Wednesday. Friday. Thank you. I did graduate from college. I promise. If you would, if you have a Bible or you like to use your phone like me, go to 1 Corinthians 9. 1 Corinthians 9, 24 through 27. To give you some context, because I did have an undergrad in theology. I'm about to graduate with my graduate studies in theology. You always gotta have biblical context. Always biblical context. Paul planted the church in Corinth. You can read about that in Acts 18, but he planted it, and now he's writing a letter back to the church. He's writing a letter talking to them who this church is excited about Jesus. They're passionate. They're learning how to follow him, and they're doing it in a culture that is very morally corrupt, pagan temples set up all over, and a lot of debating of theology in their minds. And so Paul, as he's writing to this church, he brings them back to a place to focus on dedicating their lives to the pursuit of Jesus. And if you can get one word out of this message today, it's to be consecrated. He writes about living consecrated, dedicated to a sacred purpose. And so if you would look at 1 Corinthians 9, starting in verse 24, Paul uses the imagery of kind of Olympic games. They were called the Isthmian Games back then, very similar to the Olympics. They happened every 2 years in Corinth. And so he uses this imagery to connect living dedicated for Jesus like that as a runner or an athlete. So in verse 24, it says, "Do you not know that those who run in a race, they all run, but only one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may win. Everyone who competes in the games exercises self-control in all things. They then do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. Therefore, I run in such a way as not without aim. I box in such a way as not beating the air, but I discipline my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified from the prize." I want you to go with me to a much less good-looking, much more immature Augustine Mendoza. In the summer of 2010, I was in high school, and I remember I was at a youth conference at my church, and I was going to the conference for the wrong reasons. I'm sure none of you have ever done that, but I was going for the fellowship, you know what I'm saying. I love the people, mostly on the female side, and interacting and engaging and just, you know, having a good time with my friends. And I thought, wow, there's this huge conference. There was about 8,000 or 9,000 people. And I thought, man, I just wanna go and have fun. And you know what? This is my excuse to do it. So I remember going to this conference, and I hung out with an interesting crowd. I hung out with mostly athletes that definitely were not following Jesus. And they may have claimed Jesus with their mouth, but they weren't living it with their lives. And I was in this crowd, and I was enjoying being around all these people, having a good time, not really taking anything seriously. And it was in one session that the Lord transformed my life forever. He changed something in a moment that set me on a path of following what it means to be consecrated, to be set apart for a sacred purpose. And I remember it was like it was yesterday. Oh, these are some good looking men right here. Yes. Yes. Excuse me, guys. Sorry. Oh, sorry. Okay. You can tell these are joyful men right here. Some stellar dudes. I feel really honored right now. This is great. I don't laugh, Gabe, don't laugh. I remember it was like it was yesterday because I was sitting in the back row. This is not the back row, but this is as far as TV would let me go. And I remember sitting there surrounded by my friends. They were disengaged. There weren't AirPods back then, but they would have been wearing AirPods. They were texting, they were hanging out, and there was this powerful worship set going on. I was disengaged. I was not engaged with what God was doing. And I remember the speaker came on the stage. It was Pastor Joel Stockstill. And I had no idea who he was. Didn't really care. He had a weird Southern accent. So I was like, okay, cool. Southern preacher, you know. And he came out and he was simple, but something he did, something the Holy Spirit did, marked my life in that moment. Something he said caught my attention. He said, you cannot say you follow Jesus and your life not line up with it. You have to learn how to live consecrated. And there was something when he said consecrated that the Holy Spirit did to grab my attention. And I remember just locking eyes up at the front and being like, what is going on? I don't even want to pay attention, but I just felt drawn. And I remember being locked into what he was saying. And I remember his whole message. I could give it to you point for point, every scripture he used. I don't know that about any other message. So just his. Sorry, everybody. Sorry, Eric. but I remember sitting there thinking, God, what are you doing right now? I felt almost like frozen. And I remember him at the end of his message giving an altar call. And he said, if you know you've not been living for God, you've just been saying you're living for God, you need to come down here and repent. And he said, with every head up and every eye open, I want you to stand up and I want you to go to the front and repent. You know what I did? Not me. Nope, nope, nope. And then he said something that went right to my core. He said, there are some young men in this place who are bound in pornography. And because you are bound, you feel afraid to come forward thinking that God will not accept you until you get better, until you clean up. He said, if that's you, you need to come up here and repent too. And he read my mail. He read it, and that was exactly where I was. I was trapped in a cycle of pornography. I was a people pleaser to the max, looking to perform for everybody. And my outlet was pornography to make me feel better. And I just remember in that moment, God, you read my mail. You called me out. I'm done with this. I want to live consecrated. And I don't know what made me stand in that moment because all my friends around me were still disengaged. They still didn't care. They probably didn't hear a word of that message, but here, as I looked at my friends who were not paying attention, and I looked up at Pastor Joel, I said, I want that. I want what he has. I want this joy. I don't want this. And I remember to this day standing, and I felt the glares of my friends. Bro, what are you doing? Bro, sit down. Maybe these are just the lies of the enemy, but I remember thinking, I have to get past them. I have to get past this. I have to go have my encounter with Jesus. Some of you need to get past some people in order to encounter Jesus. Some of you, the Lord is gonna stir something today, this weekend, next week, and you're gonna have a lie that says, what will they think about you? Sit back down. Hey, you can't minister to them if you go away from them. Let me just tell you, God needs to get you alone. God wants to get you alone to mark you. And when you're ready, he will bring you back to those people. But sometimes it's gonna be awkward and you're gonna have to figure out how to get past people, these tight seats. Ugh. Sometimes they're gonna try to stop you as you're going out and be like, bro, what about after the service? Bro, aren't we gonna still hang? Man, I'm not worried about that. I gotta meet with Jesus. And there may be bags that get in the way. There may be baggage that you have that's gonna lie and try to hold you back. There's gonna be baggage of addiction. There's gonna be baggage of pornography. There's gonna be baggage of pride. There's gonna be baggage from mistakes that you made, and you need to leave that in the row. You need to leave it behind. Here's my challenge to you. Don't leave today. Don't leave your time at ORU still holding on to baggage. Maybe your friends aren't even bad. I'm not saying your friends are bad, but maybe they're just not really dedicated. They're apathetic, and you can feel it because when you're around them, you don't want to pursue Jesus more. You want to check out more. I might be talking about a neighbor right now. Don't look at him. Don't look at him. That's bad. But I remember coming to the front and getting on my knees, and Allie will tell you, I'm not a crier. I don't cry. It's not like I don't want to. I just can't. It just doesn't come. Need to drink more water or whatever. I don't know. And I just remember getting on my knees and bawling my eyes out. And that's when I felt just such a warmth within me. It was a comforting warmth. It was a convicting warmth. I love what Pastor Paul Doherty says. He says, conviction is a blessing. And the minute you receive that understanding that when you feel conviction, it's a blessing, it's because God cares about you. It's because he doesn't want you to leave the house. A lot of times we may feel the conviction. We say, oh, I don't want that. I'm gonna go the opposite. No, Jesus says, feel my conviction. It's me as a coach saying, no, if you do that, it will suck on game day. Sometimes I remember thinking back to my high school years, and I remember the season I was playing in, we were 10-0. We were feeling ourselves. We thought we were awesome. And I remember because we were feeling awesome, all full of ourselves, we went to Carl's Jr. before the game, 2 hours before the game. We had that double bacon Western cheeseburger, y'all. And I had that with fries and a Powerade. Don't ask me why I got a Powerade. It's just, now I got it. And I remember eating it and my coach coming into the locker room. He says, what the are you doing? And I'll just let you fill in the blank of what he said. He wasn't saved. And I was like, oh, crap. And we were like, the captain of the team, he said, coach, don't worry about it. We're 10-0. This is just our fuel for game day. Coach said, if we lose, you're going to regret ever eating that burger. And I was scared. My coach don't play. And I remember we went out there. We won, okay, because we're awesome. We were. And I remember coming back into that locker room, and I remember feeling something on my stomach. I'd held it off, and I'll let you guys use your imagination for what happened for the rest of that day. Carl's Jr. came back at me. That's what happened. It came back. Why do I say all that? I believe in this place, Holy Spirit wants to be a coach for the next 15 minutes. Holy Spirit wants to coach you. Holy Spirit wants to challenge you. And I don't want you to hear the voice of condemnation. I want you to hear the voice of conviction. The one that says, I want you to be the best that you can be. But we can't be the best that God's called us to be if we just live whimsical, lackadaisical. It will behoove you. It will behoove you to lean into the voice of the Holy Spirit this morning. Everybody say amen. Amen. Jesus, we listen. We listen to you as our coach. Holy Spirit, would you put a spotlight on things that need to have a spotlight? We give you permission to do things in us this morning. We get ourselves out of the way. We say, Lord, would you increase? And would we decrease? You increase, we decrease. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Can we get up for Alex? He's like legit. He's like really legit. I want to show you a picture from the end of that conference that I was just talking about. At the end, they asked everyone to write on a whiteboard, who will you be in 10 years from now? Remember, this is 2010. We got that picture. Don't laugh at me, please. Don't laugh. Oh, yeah. Oh, Oz. That's cute. Thank you. Thank you. A beard does a lot. Let me just say, a beard. Thank you, God. Thank you for always being good. Little did I know that when I wrote this in high school, the summer of 2010, that it was a prophetic declaration that the Lord would use. As I was preparing for this message, I came across this way back in the archives, and I'm kind of sad I found it, but I'm kind of glad. And let me just tell you, this declaration, I will be living a pure life. I can stand before you in boldness and confidence today and say, I have no addiction to pornography. I am not bound in lust. I am free. And the Lord broke open the cell door on that day and said, you don't have to live here anymore. You don't have to stay in this anymore. But let me just tell you also, it was a process. I can't say that from the moment I stood up crying my eyes out on that floor that I never struggled with pornography again. I can't say that. But I can say the grace increased. His mercy increased. My understanding as a son increased. And let me just say, if there's anyone that struggles with pornography, here's the greatest thing I learned. It's a journey. It's a step day after day after day. And you just have to be faithful to keep stepping, to keep on stepping. And sometimes you're gonna be running and you're gonna smack down on your face and you're gonna be like, oh my gosh, I'm such a failure. But guess what? Your Father defines you. Not a mistake, not a website. Your Father defines you. So get back up. There is more and you can do it. Amen. So you're saying, Augustine, I love it. I want to live dedicated. I want to live consecrated, set apart for my sacred purpose. Because guess what? You do have a sacred purpose. You know how I know? Because you're here. You are studying for something bigger than yourself. Okay? If you just came here to get a degree so you can make money, you could have done that at a lot of other universities. But you're here because you want to learn to hear the voice of God. You want an anointing for your business. You want an anointing in the nursing world. You want an anointing in the media world. We need it. We need it. But if you want that, you have to learn how to live dedicated, consecrated to your sacred purpose. So three things I'm gonna give you, three things. I'm a practical guy, I need practicality. I need to learn how to walk it out. In this case, run it out. First point, run after Jesus. Run after Jesus. Verse 24, it says, do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but only one receives the prize? So run in such a way that you may win. Personally, this is not with years of study. Personally, I believe one of the greatest tactics of the enemy in your generation is one word, apathy. And guess where it's most easy to be apathetic? Right here. Why? Because you assume you're always gonna have this. You think, oh, there'll be another chapel service next week. I got a church service on Sunday. You know, when we go to a meeting or classroom, there's gonna be prayer. So you start to lean back. We cannot be apathetic. If you want to make a difference, you have to learn how to follow Jesus hard now. Because guess what? It gets harder after graduation. Because you're not gonna have every meeting with prayer. You're not gonna walk in and everyone's like, let's just worship. Yeah, let's just do it. There's like five worship nights a night on this campus. You can go somewhere and you're not gonna have a worship night all month. That's because you have to start that worship night. That's because you have to lead the prayer meeting. That's because you have to lead the way by running after Jesus. But just like you can't wait till field test day, you gotta start learning to be dedicated to running after Jesus now. See, what you're doing is you're building up spiritual endurance. You know, I learned this truth here at ORU, and if you could learn this, it'll save you a whole lot of pain later. It's that Jesus cares more about your heart than your ministry. Some of us are waiting for God to give his dreams and vision for what he has next, but he's not gonna give that to us until we've rooted ourselves in intimacy with him. Why? Because if we get the picture of the dream, we're just gonna go run to that. When Jesus has run to me, and then I'll give you that. So if you don't have clarity, if you don't know what you're supposed to major in, you don't know what you're gonna do after graduation, seniors, you don't know what your job is gonna be, I would say put that on the shelf. It's important, but Jesus is more important. And if he knows that you have given him everything, literally everything, then he will provide. But give him your heart. He cares more about your heart than your ministry. Number two, choose your crown. Paul says, everyone who competes in the games exercises self-control in all things. Why? They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable wreath. I have a picture of Olympic wreaths, and these were what the Greeks used for the Isthmian Games and later on in the Olympics, and they crowned the winners of every event with these wreaths. And Paul is referring to these and saying, hey, runners run for these. Pole vaulters pole vault for these. When we compete for things, we run for crowns. And we may not run for crowns that are leaves, but we may run for crowns like man's approval, popularity, business success, financial gain, achievement, pleasure, happiness, my best life. You gotta be careful that your crown, what you're aiming for, is really not about you. Because the minute you say, I want my best life, this is my crown. Oh, I want my happiness, I want my pleasure, I want my finances to be off the charts. Hey, look, none of those things are bad. But when that's what you're running for, you're gonna burn out. See, Paul knows that the imperishable crown that you will receive when you walk, cross through the gates of heaven, when you hear your name read in the Lamb's Book of Life, that crown is worth it. But a lot of times we don't think about that. A lot of times we think about now, next year, this semester, next year, graduation, job, money, marriage. All these things are necessary, but they're not your crown. And if you focus on that, you will find out weeks, months, years later, my life is so self-centric. How did that happen? It's because your crown was not upon the head of Jesus. You had put it upon yourself. Choose your crown. This was something that a professor told me in a theology class, and it challenged me in how I think. He said, you have to decide in your heart if you're running for the American dream or the kingdom dream. Let me just say, I love America. I love being able to have drive-throughs everywhere. I love that we live in a place where things are easily accessible, but that can't be my crown. Convenience cannot be my crown. What I get cannot be my crown. I have to have something more. My challenge to you this morning is don't let a crown here in the context of ORU be a position. There's something, I was in a lot of positions at ORU. I loved working as an MC in the missions office. I love being a chaplain. I love being in prayer movement. But if we're not careful, our titles start to define what we desire. But your crown should supersede all of that. Why? Because Jesus supersedes all of that. So fix your eyes on a crown that will last and will not just be for a season. Jesus says, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So how's your crown today? What's your crown today? Where's your heart today? Last thing. And this is the most fun thing. Not really. Embrace discipline. Yes. Paul says in verse 25, exercise self-control in all things. Everybody say all things. All things. Then in verse 27, he says, I discipline my body. Some translations, which I love, he says, I beat my body. Make it my slave so that after I have preached to others, after I have lived in my sacred purpose, I will not be disqualified. Let me tell you, I know people that I went to school with that were on fire for the Lord, but because they did not embrace discipline here, as soon as they got out of this place, they folded. And I would say that it wasn't their heart to, it wasn't their desire to. They didn't leave ORU thinking, now I'm just gonna do whatever I want. They chose a lifestyle because they had not become rooted in discipline. My biggest encouragement to you, and I meet with guys here on campus all the time, and I say you have to embrace discipline. You have to, you have to, you have to. Look, anything you wanna do in life requires discipline. Or let me say, anything that's worth doing requires discipline. You wanna be a good student? What do you gotta do? Study. Some of you got that. It's good, it's good. Welcome to college. Hey, if you wanna do good on your field tests, what do you gotta do? Study. Study on the track. That's what you gotta do. Hey, if you wanna get really good at an instrument, what do you gotta do? Hey, if you wanna beat the staff and alumni basketball team in intramurals this year, what you gotta do? Yeah, you gonna have to practice because Eric and I are coming for you. We were like fourth overall last year, so no big deal. Hey, you wanna have spiritual goals, physical goals, intellectual goals. Discipline is the bridge that will get you there. I'm not gonna sugarcoat it for you. You have to walk across the bridge of discipline. Paul says, I beat my body. I discipline myself so that, get this, you will not be disqualified. Are you living in a way where your discipline is greater than anything that could disqualify you? Some of you need to get out of yourself and get up in the morning and go pray. This is a consecrated season for you. And I don't say this to condemn you. I say this because I want to prepare you. I don't want you to end up like some friends that I know. I want you to catch the conviction of discipline and say, Jesus, I want you more than anything. And I'm not just gonna sing it in chapel. I'm gonna live it. Come on. You know, right now, let me just clarify. Right now, I think LeBron James is the best basketball player in the world. MJ is the GOAT, but LeBron is the best basketball player right now. Hey, he's got some talent. He's got some gifting. So do you. But the reason why LeBron James is the greatest right now is because he didn't let his body, his feeling, or his emotions dictate his direction. Don't discredit those things. Listen to those things. But see, the best athlete learns how to lead his body, not follow it. Are you leading your body? Are you leading your emotions? Are you leading your spiritual growth? Or are you following the people in your row? Are you following what someone does on a stage? Pain is inevitable in life. Amen. But you can choose your pain. You can choose the pain of discipline, or you can choose the pain of regret. Which are you gonna choose? Because I can't choose for you. Josh and Kimmy can't choose for you. President Wilson can't choose for you. Your professors can't choose for you. Are you gonna choose the pain of discipline? The pain of disciplining yourself to get up in the morning, to go run, to go work out, to go study? Or are you gonna choose the pain of regret when you got a cram for that test the night before? Or when that 12-page paper is due and you said, ooh, I got the introduction done. The title page, yes. Or are you gonna choose the pain of discipline? I would encourage you to choose the former. See, your dedication, your consecrated lifestyle is dependent upon your discipline. And hear my heart, Jesus has grace for you. He wants to meet you where you're at. He doesn't expect you to arrive today or tomorrow, but he does expect movement. He's calling you to move. The kingdom of God is a kingdom that is moving, that is advancing. We cannot become stagnant because we're lazy or apathetic. This is a quote that I heard, and I really have made it a core value of my life. If you want to see radical transformation, you have to respond with radical obedience. Radical transformation is dependent upon radical obedience. Read the Bible. I could use a lot of different stories. Read the Bible. People that do crazy, radical, obedient things for God see amazing, radical transformation in themselves, in their families, in their communities, in their nation. But it takes radical obedience. God was stirring me in that back row at conference, saying, you're not living radically obedient. You say you are, you sing like you are, but you're not. And only God and you can know where your heart is on that. But I would venture to say that there are people in this room that want to see radical transformation in you, in your family, in your future job. Maybe God wants to use you to shape a nation, to change an industry, to do something amazing. But he says, here's the prerequisite, radical obedience. If I was to go around this room and ask you, how is God calling you to be radically obedient in this season? Maybe some of you could tell me. But my follow-up question would be, so are you doing it? Are you living in it? I pray that conviction in this place would stir you like a coach to pursue all that God has for your sacred purpose in radical obedience. If everyone would stand in this place, I'm gonna ask, if you're a chaplain, I want you to take your spots. Take your spots. If you're a chaplain, you know where you're supposed to go. Hey, everybody, eyes up here, real quick. Real quick. Hey, I want you to close your eyes, and I want you to take 30 seconds. That's all I want. 30 seconds. Because some of you need someone to partner with you to make that conviction a reality. You know you're never gonna do it on your own without help from community. And there are some amazing men and women of God, not perfect men and women of God, not men and women of God that have it all together, but those that wanna partner with you. Hey, if you wanna go fast, go alone. If you wanna go far, go together. Live the Christian walk in context of community. Ask Jesus this one question, just you and Jesus right now. Does radical obedience define my life? Am I defined by the word consecrated, or am I defined by the word compromise? Only you and him can know that. I'm gonna pray, and as I pray, if you feel led, I want you to get out of your seat and go to your chaplain right now. Don't wait. Why wait? He's called you now. And then when I finish, you're dismissed. But if you want to linger, worship, pray, allow God to let this be a moment that radically transforms you by a radical step of obedience. Jesus, in this place, we humble ourselves. We consecrate our hearts to you, God, and we say, have your way in our lives. We dedicate ourselves as sons and daughters to our sacred purpose. God, we declare our dependency upon you. Thank you, God, that you meet us where we're at. Oh, I just feel right now, there are some people, today is your day of freedom. Today is the day that the jail door is ripped off. It may be pornography like me, it may be something else, you know what it is, you need to come and find a chaplain. Don't leave this place without finding a chaplain. God's stirring that right now. And so Jesus, in this place, we surrender. God, we get out of the way so that you can have your way in us. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
This has been a presentation of Oral Roberts University, a world-renowned and fully accredited Christian university with more than 100 undergraduate majors and minors, as well as graduate degrees in business, education, and theology. If you or someone you know is thinking about college but not sure what to expect, then visit us today at oru.edu. Make no little plans here.